We are on camera.
Okay, today is April the 11th, 2019, correct? It is 10:45 a.m. in Atlanta, Georgia, at the Atlanta History Center. First of all, we're here today to interview Albert L. Boemker, who is a Vietnam veteran. First of all, sir, let me thank you for being here and for volunteering to do this.
I appreciate that, and I see your CIB, so thank you, too.
Well, I had the fortune or misfortune to serve also and in the same area you did, so I'm going to be very interested in hearing your stories. We're here today to conduct this interview. This interview will be in the archives, kept in the archives at the Atlanta History Center, in conjunction with the Library of Congress under what we call the Legacy Project. A copy of this interview will go to the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C., so that your descendants, your friends, your relatives down the road, and anybody that's doing research on Vietnam, and maybe even the 11th Armored Cavalry Regiment, might very well find your interview on there. So I want to thank you for being here. Can you tell us a little bit, just give us who you are and tell us a little bit, don't give us the exact street address, but tell us where you're living today. And
Today. Okay, we'll start there. Living in Dunwoody, Georgia, suburb north of Atlanta. Used to be the Golden Ghetto. It's not anymore. It's moved out to Johns Creek in that area.
Okay.
It used to be that you could tell how a Dunwoody housewife was going to a funeral. She wore her black tennis dress. So that's the kind of neighborhood that I'm living in now. But I did not grow up that way. I was born in Covington, Kentucky, right across the river from Cincinnati, Ohio. River town, had been flooded a number of times over the years. My daddy's house when he was a kid was underwater. And he grew up in the Great Depression. I'm the oldest of 10 kids. I've been back to visit. The house I lived in was built during the Civil War. It's an old town. It's a railroad town. Down the street was a roundhouse where they would take the trains in and maneuver them around so that they could get fixed. We grew up playing ball there. Grew up playing ball inside of a fuel tank. Maybe you've seen some up in Doraville. And we would play ball inside where the tank, we got together, so let's meet at the tank. And actually, my next door neighbor went up there. He one of his jobs was putting out fires, and that place caught on fire many years later. My next door neighbor put out the fire there. It's still a very different sort of town than Atlanta, Georgia. It's really, really old, and I was not unhappy leaving there, but I had great friends, and we moved a little bit of a suburb out called Erlanger, Kentucky, where I spent third grade, and I moved to Atlanta, Georgia for 1 year. It was a very important year in my life, and this is not even in this book, but I went to Catholic school, and our nun got sick, and they couldn't replace her. They didn't have any way to replace her, so the other nuns would come in and try to take care of us, and they did as best they could, but they had to take care of their classes. And education in Georgia is not the best anyway. Catholic school is probably better. It wasn't known for its education. Then I moved to Arlington, Virginia. My dad was in the Southern Railroad. His whole working career was Southern Railroad. And he was a payroll accountant. And when we moved to Arlington, we moved in. It was, again, an older house, but it was in a neighborhood that was well-to-do and is still one of the most wealthy neighborhoods around is Arlington. And my neighbor's kids were congressmen, senators. My best friend's daddy was chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission. Here's just a side story you'll enjoy. I was there for the Bay of Pigs. Not the Bay of Pigs, the one before. The Cuban Missile Crisis. And this guy's daddy sent out notes to people in the neighborhood that he's going to have a party. at his house. And he wasn't like the other adults that I knew. He had been in the OSS in World War II, worked his way through school to become a nuclear scientist. That's how he got the job. I'd be at his house and pick up the phone. You had to answer a certain way. Conway resident, Al Boemker speaking, how am I help you, sir? Same thing with general officers, how am I help you, sir? And it'd be the vice president on the phone, who was in charge of the nuclear aspects of the United States, and it was Lyndon Johnson. And wow. He was calling about the USS Thrasher, which went down. I had a jacket from that. The daddy would go to places, nuclear submarines, and being a VIP, they give him a Navy field coat. And he had so many of them, he gave me one. That when I went in the Army, my brothers did something with it, I never saw it again. So that's the kind of people I grew up with. Anyway, the point of his being different than the adults that I remember when I was a kid, and we all probably remember how our parents acted. They didn't act like him. So the party was about the Cuban Missile Crisis, and it was a kiss your ass goodbye party. And that blew me away as a kid. And my parents did not talk like that. They were strong Catholics. I had to set an example for 10 kids. The point of that story is when I got there, I'm not only in the best public school system in the country and has been ever since. My high school was the third best high school in the country, according to people that ranked them, and it's never been out of the top 100. And most of that time in the top 10 for the last 40 or 50 years. And I couldn't cut it. I was so far behind from not having had good grades in third grade that they put me back. They put me in fourth grade and sent me back to third. I mean, they put me in fifth grade now and sent me back to fourth grade. And that's right. I said third grade. It was fourth grade. And that was devastating to a kid. And so I decided I didn't like school anymore, and I I became a troubled child. And that was not good for my parents. They were paying money to send me to Catholic school. I was a really good football player on a really good program, but I wasn't good enough to get to the good football schools. I was good enough to get offers. And you remember back then, there was no limit on scholarships.
Right.
So Georgia could give 100 scholarships a year if they wanted, and everybody else had to take the dregs. So I got some offers from really good schools, but I didn't feel comfortable academically going there. Plus, my daddy couldn't afford to get me from here to there, like William & Mary and Washington and Lee, which was the name of the high school I went to, and University of Virginia.
So did you graduate high school
I
in Arlington?
But I didn't go. I don't know if scholarships are still on offer. I came down here my senior year and didn't play ball because they had issues with eligibility. It was only when I went in the Army and I started working for people who were, quite frankly, not all, but some of them were just dumb as bricks. And if they had one more stripe than you, you had to listen to them and obey them. And so I made the decision. One of the most profound things I brought home from Vietnam was a desire to go to school. I wanted to work for somebody smarter than me. Whatever the job was, I wanted my boss to be smarter than me. So I went to college at Georgia State. I worked full-time.
This is after the Army,
This is
right?
After I came home. I went to Georgia State for it. Took me 7 years to graduate, going to school part-time and working full-time. I was working with the Atlanta Parks and Recreation Department, and I didn't have to be there until school was out. So to make some money, I started substitute teaching. The guy I worked with actually had two full-time jobs. He taught elementary school PE, and he ran the gym. Went on to become a principal in the city of Atlanta. Good man. And he said, come on out and be a substitute teacher. So I'm a substitute teacher now. If you all been around here long enough, you may remember the housing projects up on Bankhead Highway called Bankhead Courts. And I was in Bankhead Courts Elementary School, as I what it's called. Mm-hmm. And I decided I liked it, and I thought I was good at it, so I became a teacher. But all that came, and then went and got my master's degree. But all that came about because in Vietnam I decided I had to go back to school.
All right, now I'm going to back you up on that. I want to get back to that, but may I
yes,
back
absolutely.
You up
please,
to
anytime.
What year did you graduate high school?
1966.
1966. And that was from the Catholic school in Arlington?
No, no. By this time, I'd moved
back to Atlanta.
Back to Atlanta. In 1965, I moved to Atlanta. So my senior year was at Walter F. George High School, named for a United States Senator. Interesting place, right off of I-75. You can see it from the expressway. It's now middle school, right before you get to Hayville. And on one side, or on the side of it, was Black Label Brewery and Gordon's Potato Chip Factory. So you smell that every day.
I know exactly where you're talking about.
Okay.
It was Pabst Blue Ribbon was what was
yes,
manufactured.
Yes, it eventually became PBR.
That's
right. Who was the first sponsor of the Peace Street Road Race.
That's right. That's correct.
Well.
Now I know why you're a history professor.
Yeah. When I first started teaching in the city of Atlanta, that's where I went to teach. And I spent 20 years at the same high school I graduated from.
Wow.
While I was there, they changed its name. Fulton High School closed, and they merged with Walter F. George and became South Atlanta High School.
I see.
So I spent 20 years teaching at that same high school, same neighborhood I went to. The difference is it went from all white to all black.
Yeah.
Except for me.
Right.
And there were many days I didn't know I was a white guy. I mean, I didn't see any white people. But anyway, that was that. But family, let's go back to family. My daddy was in the United States Marine Corps, served at Iwo Jima. That had an impact on his life, had an impact on our life, because when he came back, and by the time he has all these kids, we basically lived in a barracks. Certainly the last 3 or 4 years that I was at home, we lived in a barracks. And there were five boys and five girls, and all five boys were in one big room in the basement, two bunk beds and one single bed. Being the oldest, I got the single bed. And every Saturday morning, we had inspection. We had inspection. And the first thing, he knew what he was going to do. The first thing he did when he walked in the door was reach up and try to find dust up on the door sill. So between him and the nuns, and they were tougher than the DIs. Both of them were tougher than the DIs I had. Basic training was not hard for me. They weren't near as tough. They weren't as mean. They weren't as physical as the nuns were. The nuns would hit you back then. So basic training wasn't hard for me after growing up that way.
So did you enter the Army right after you graduated from high school?
Within a few months. I went to work for the telephone company as an installer repairman. And it looked like I was going to get drafted. And I did not want to. And I was smart enough to say, maybe I don't want to be a Marine. Maybe I don't want to be in the infantry. So I went for 3 years. It meant I didn't have to do 4 years of inactive reserve, 3 years total. And I was going to go become a clerk. That's what I qualified for. And then something bad happened. I scored high enough on the IQ test. They tell me you are OCS qualified. Now, I got that information in basic training.
Uh-huh. Where'd you do your basic?
Fort Benning. Fort Benning, Georgia. July.
Fort Benning School for Boys?
Yeah, oh boy. Yeah. I went in July.
It's now school for everybody.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they moved the armor down there.
Right.
And the museum is fantastic.
It is.
I went back since they did it. I've been three times.
Yeah.
And they put the armor museum down there. And so I went down with one of my sons for that. And I went down the other one before. So anyway, they told me I qualified for OCS on a day that was like 100 degrees. The hottest summer in history down there. Not the highest temperature wasn't always the hottest, but it never got below 80 at night. It was brutal. Now, the good thing about it was we didn't have to march to the rifle ranges. We got bussed because it was too hot for us to march to the rifle range. So it saved us that, but it was hot. I'm pulling KP, pots and pans, which is the toughest thing. You don't want pots and pans. You're in the grease all day. It's hot. You're sweaty. It's a tin roof. It's 100 degrees outside. It's 130 in front of that grease thing. And there's not a dry spot in your body. Your glasses are steamed up, be hot coming up. And I get a letter from the Army saying I qualify for OCS. I got to do this stuff anymore.
It's an easy decision.
So that was an easy. But in order to do that, I had to go to infantry basic training instead of going to become a clerk. So that's how I ended up in the infantry. Okay, side story. Back to my military people. I had an Uncle Mac, served in First World War. He was my mother's uncle, so he got that experience. I served. One of my brothers was drafted. He became a conscientious objector, but went in to become a medic. And about the time he went to basic and he went to medical school, he had a heart murmur. And he got out of the military, so he didn't have to serve. But he went in, he's going to do it. He would have gone probably to Vietnam. I don't think it was over yet. He still had that heart murmur. He recently got cancer, and they were wondering about what treatment, because they identified that heart murmur that he had. But he went in. My nephew, one of my sister's boys, always wanted to be a Marine. He went in the Marine Reserve and then went to Iraq. Mm-hmm. Made the front page of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution about his military story. The Marines apparently decided that they didn't want men in the unit, as one of my stories is about men in the unit, who take care of your personal possessions after you leave them, either KIA or WIA, wounded or killed in action. Mm-hmm. And I don't know where I was going with that.
Front page of the AJC?
You said the Marine Corps didn't want...
Oh, okay, the Marines decided they wanted... I keep moving back and forth. I hope that didn't hurt your light. The Marines decided they didn't want guys in the unit doing that, that was bad for morale. So they created a special unit of guys from Graves Registration to go out and pick up the remains and the personal effects of the guys in the unit rather than have their buddies do it. And that was his job.
Terrible job.
Terrible job.
Yeah.
And it's dangerous. You know, we're on the road all the time, but you don't want to be on the road in Iraq. That's where they put the IEDs.
Right.
One of my Purple Hearts came from an IED, but it was different. It was the same principle.
Right.
They took a 250-pound bomb, put it in the road, and they would blow it up several ways. One would be of a pressure plate, so they'd only get the heavy vehicles.
Right.
Another was with a wire-operated detonator. They would, you know, you'd put the plastic explosive on the big bomb and blow it up that way. Nowadays, they do it by telephone. Or radio signal. Or
command something. Detonator.
And the one that hit us, he apparently did it a little bit too soon. And so he didn't get the bomb underneath the vehicle. He just got kind of the front of it and threw us up and over. That's one of the stories I'm going to tell. Nobody got killed. The driver messed up his elbow. He had to have steel rods or something put in his elbow, but nobody got killed by it. But again, going stream of consciousness, I kind of forget where I was, but that was his job, and it had to be very emotionally tough on him and physically dangerous being on the road of all those IEDs. And of course,
right.
They would often set up secondary ambushes when the first responders come in, but he got home, he got married, he's got two kids, became a police officer.
Oh, good. So,
now he's stopped doing that because he's got two kids.
Right.
And he got a better job. Certainly, mm-hmm. He's home every night with his kids. My brother-in-law, one of my brother-in-laws, was an MP when my sister married him. Got married at Fort Mac right out here.
Uh-huh.
She served with him on his duty station, which is a great duty station. He was in, I think, Brussels. At NATO headquarters as an MP. And so they got to travel through Europe and came home. He became a police officer in Clayton County. He decided for his retirement that he's getting police retirement, but he decided he wanted to go back and join the reserves. And he had to do it. And he'd been a sergeant when he was in on active duty, but he decided he's going to go back in as an officer. So he had just barely made the last date that you could do to qualify for OCS. So he went to OCS and became an officer. MPs, and then they retrain him to do other things, like one of which was to be a first responder for emergencies like hurricanes or floods or stuff. So he trained to do that. And somehow or other, that became his MOS as he's now serving in Iraq. So I got relatives right now, and they say most folks nowadays don't even know anybody that's been there. And his job essentially, I guess because of the training for the emergencies or whatnot, is to be like the mayor of a small town. He runs the base. Just making sure things get fixed and plumbing works and, you know, all that sort of stuff. But he's out on a small outpost. He could have gone one or two places, that place or the green zone, which is a really good place to be, really the safest place you could be if you're a military over there in that place. But he's out.
Let me get you back to you.
Okay.
I want to ask you, you thought you might be drafted. You told us off the record a little bit about you thought about the Marine Corps, and that didn't exactly work out. Dad wouldn't sign off, and things didn't work out. So you joined the Army and enlisted. One day doing pots and pans, I'm just trying to catch us up here, you find out you're eligible for OCS. Did you go to OCS?
I did go to OCS. Okay. Now, that's another story that's not in this review.
We don't care.
This is Army. That's just Vietnam. First of all, it got sent to Fort McClellan, Alabama. And at that time, Fort McClellan, Alabama had two things going for it. It had two functions. The oldest was the Army Chemical School. Smartest guys in the Army were the Army Chemical School. And it's still a dangerous place to be. They still got all those weapons stockpiled at a Army weapons or depot down there where they store them. The other thing it was the WAC Training Center. It was the only place in the Army at that time, 66, 67, that trained WACs. Now, I got a story about that. I can tell you that story now. Okay?
Please.
Tell you the story. See, we're doing stream of consciousness here. Mm-hmm. When we first went there, there were more women than men on the base. But then it seemed like every week a new company of about 160 guys would show up for advanced infantry training, and all of them were pre-OCS. That's where they sent all the guys who were going to go to OCS after they did their individual infantry or individual training, but that's what it was. Not a bad place to be. Had mountains around it. I can remember it snowing, and the snow stayed up on the mountains, and we would climb those mountains. I can remember carrying a bazooka, an old, big, heavy bazooka. It was my job to carry on one particular day when we sat down to eat lunch, and I sat on a scorpion's nest, and there were little ones, so but how high can you jump, right? They didn't bite me, but I sat on it, and they were little guys, you know, but still. They had a dance in town, Anniston, Alabama. And a soldier would go there, but there weren't many soldiers going there. There weren't many soldiers there. But now we got 160 coming each week. And so a friend of mine I want to talk about who came from Michigan, and we became buddies there. And he started coming home with me. Cause I came home on the weekends when I could. I didn't like the Army. I make that clear up front. I hated the Army. I love the guys I served with in Vietnam. They're my brothers. But I didn't like the Army. So I would come home on the weekend and play sandlot football with my buddies, and he would come with me. This particular fella was a real good football player, took a scholarship at Michigan State, got casual about his studies, flunked out, and got drafted. And we went to the dance. And we were the first group, I think, maybe the second, that were these new 160 guys coming in every week for months. And we went to the dance, and he made a mistake of talking to some Alabama boy's girlfriend. So the next thing you know, there are words exchanged, and words are back and forth, and a fight ensues. And I'm a lover. I'm not a fighter. So I sat in the background and got my buddy out of there because the Army justice wouldn't even be as bad as small-town Alabama justice. So we got out of there before it got too bad. And there were other soldiers there. So his incident sparked it, but it wasn't the only fisticuffs going on. I wasn't involved in that. And the next week, guys at the base heard about it. Everybody's telling stories. So a few hundred of us, of them, not us, of them, went in to get revenge with the
at
local
the dance,
Alabama
at
boys.
The dance.
Ron and I went to Atlanta. He started it, but I said, we ain't going to that. We're going to Atlanta. So we weren't involved in that. But after that, we stayed there. Well, I went in, let's see, July to August, a couple weeks, September, October, we were out of basic of AIT. But he had to wait now for about 2 months to get orders because they were backlogged to get classes to go into OCS. So we were backlogged.
The OCS was at Benning?
Is it Fort Benning Infantry School.
Right.
And I went, and I felt, first of all, it's incredible. This is not in this article either, so you can take notes if you should. I knew how bad it was going to be. We'd heard stories. They've been, you know, they try to scare you.
About OCS?
And I had orders to go from McClellan to Benning. I went home. I'll never forget the day. It was the day of the very first ever Super Bowl, January 15th, 1967. And I had a report that day. So I stayed home, ironing my uniforms, trying to put spray starch on them and make them look sharp, which they didn't. I got down there, and they were terrible, and I got chewed out repeatedly for these poor uniforms, which I had spent all day ironing. And my girlfriend and future first wife drove me down, and I got in as late as I could on that day. And even then, the first 24 hours, I probably did 2,000 push-ups. The senior officers come in, and they're like tactical officers. Now, you have tactical. If you went to OCS, I don't know how you got your commission.
I was ROTC, but I was a TAC officer at OCS.
You know what I'm talking about. Was it what branch?
I was, at that time, I was artillery. I was Army artillery.
Okay.
But
that was a smart guy.
But I was a TAC officer at Infantry OCS.
At Benning?
Yeah.
Then you know.
Yeah.
And some of them were just recent graduates of OCS who themselves then became tactical officers.
Right.
My guy looked like, and we called him behind his back, Spanky, because he looked like Spanky from our gang. But he was a real deal. He was tough. And you know, you were a tactical officer. You want these guys to show initiative. You know,
right.
You probably said this yourself many times, make a decision, right or wrong, make a decision, candidate. So you got to make a decision.
We used to have a thing where somebody would say, we'd put them out there in front of a platoon. Somebody would say, gentlemen, let's do something. We used to call that, let's have a lollipop.
Now that I didn't experience.
Yeah, they were not allowed to use the terminology let's. It was do this or
yeah,
don't
do
this.
And you couldn't say, I think.
Right.
You had to say,
you're
I
not
believe.
Allowed to think.
I believe this
right.
is true, sir.
That's right.
And the senior candidates would come in then and haze you for that first couple of days. And no matter what you did, you were wrong. Get down and knock out 20. Get down and knock out 20. Get down and knock out 20. Long barracks. Bays.
Harmony Church.
Neither one. On main campus
okay.
is where it is, practically right next door to the jump school.
Okay. I know right where you were.
You're stopped. It's so to get from this end to that end, I had to go do something. I was told to go down and get this. It took me 2 hours. I could only walk 5 feet. When a senior candidate comes by, you got to stop and brace up against the wall. And then 2, 3, 4 of them are right in your face, screaming at you, asking you questions, different questions. And you learn over a period of time how to answer them. You can't lie. You know, honor code is very tough, very realistic. You can't lie. So you learn how to quibble. Did you shave, candidate? Yes, sir. He didn't ask me if I shaved today. Did you shave today? I got to say, no, sir. But did you shave? The answer is, yes, sir. They ask questions you can't answer. Are you a virgin?
That's the idea.
Yeah.
They don't
Whatever
want
you say
to.
Is wrong. If you are a virgin, you're not man enough to join my army. If you're not a virgin, you're not married, you're not moral enough to join my army. My favorite story is one of the guys I was in with. And we had a bay of four, and all alphabetical names, all similar. Charlie Bechtel, Abel. I forget the other guy's name all of a sudden. And Charlie Bechtel, we called him Double Shot because he was a happy guy, always singing songs, Double Shot of my baby's love, all the time.
Oh,
so we called him Double
that
Shot.
Song, yeah.
So we're getting, they're harassing you now as you're going into lunch line. You got to do pull-ups. The senior tactical officer had their lunch. They're out there. Not the senior. Well, the seniors, the light blue guys.
Yeah, the candidates.
But they're the seniors, and they're like,
right.
To us, they're lieutenants.
Right.
You know, they're officers. And they got us asking questions. And they asked me about who was my DI. He'd be ashamed of you. Your DI would be ashamed of you. And he, what's your name? And he made us stand looking at each other, Charlie and I. I'm still laughing about this because this is the truth. I told him the truth. Who was your DI? And I told him it was Jesus Santa Claus, which was true. And now Charlie and I are just cracking up. We're getting there, getting pissed as hell at us because we're laughing. We can't stop laughing. This is a serious candidate. We're laughing. What do you mean, Jesus Santa Claus? Well, he was a Puerto Rican. He was actually the junior DI. He was a Puerto Rican whose name was Jesus St. Nicholas Cepeda. So he was Jesus Santa Claus. Jesus St. Nicholas
enough.
Cepeda.
Close enough.
It went well.
Yeah.
I was one of the few people who didn't have a college degree. Is what I wanted to do.
The program, if I remember at that time, Al, was 26 weeks?
About that, yeah, 6 months program.
Right.
6 month program.
Right.
One of the hardest things people would never imagine, may I borrow that?
Sure.
You had your combat clipboard. And when you carried a rifle, you had to run at port arms. You couldn't walk anywhere.
Right.
You had to run everywhere, double time. Mm-hmm. But you had to carry this clipboard that had to be spit shined and polished with stuff. And putting your thumbs around that clipboard while trying to carry your rifle was an absolute pain. And you had to do it to go to the school, the classrooms. And it wasn't difficult. I mean, I can imagine that artillery training and the math involved would have thrown me for a loop. But small unit tactics and this sort of thing was not a problem academically for me. So I did well on that. Had an incident that made me a hero to some of the guys. We were out on a big night maneuver where you're aggressor forces against each other. And we were the ones that were going to be attacked. We didn't know that, but just so happened that I overheard the tactical officers who were with us and the guy that came out with us. That was his job. He was on a training course. He wasn't one of ours, but he was the training. They were talking about what was going to happen, when and where the enemy was going to attack us. And I heard it. And they're going to come down a road.
Too bad we didn't get that in Vietnam, isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah, really, come down a road, make a left turn, and attack us from that position. And so I heard about it, and I went, and here's what we did. We knew they were going to come down this road. We knew they were going to attack this way. We set up an ambush patrol on the other side of the road and ambushed them before they could attack us. So on tactical stuff, I did well. Where I didn't do well, and I don't, again, your experience is going to be very similar to this. If you give an order and you change, for people in the, hearing this some point in time, you change positions twice a week. Today I'm a private, tomorrow I'm a corporal, next day I'm a private, next day I'm a sergeant, next day I'm a private, next day I'm company commander.
Right.
And you're constantly telling each other what to do, and you learn how to deal with that. Because I'm telling you, in each platoon had its own specific duties, like who had the latrine and who had the halls. We spit-shined our floors, spit-shined them. And if somebody, tactical officers like you, would walk in with your boots on, but that was one of the hardest things. You had to take your boots off. You could not go in with your boots on. If you scraped up somebody's floor, you were going to fight. If you told somebody to do something, he didn't do it, it's your fault. You're showing poor leadership. And what do you do? Well, you can get on a typewriter and write up an ER, an efficiency report, It's all coming back to me now. Mm-hmm. That was a pain. You're getting 4 hours sleep a night. That was one of the hard, never get any sleep. You have to type it up. So, we're going to deal physically with this. And so fist fights were common.
Right.
But then eventually you get to where you know each other. I'm telling you today, you're telling me more. That's not a problem for anybody. It is a problem if they're gone.
But that is part of the program, you realize.
Teaching you leadership, absolutely.
And being taking care of your brothers.
Yeah.
And now sisters, so, now that they have both men and women in the infantry.
You know, and then you evaluate each other.
Yeah.
And I got evaluated in the top half.
Yeah.
I did have a temper. I don't know where it came from. Two quick OCS stories. Since you let me tell my story, I'm going to be here a while.
I'm eventually going to push you into Vietnam. You
okay,
know
I won't
that, right?
get there. Okay. Then we'll go to this.
I'm going to get you there.
I'm done with that.
All right.
but this is OCS. It both has to do with, there's only two black guys in my company. They're both in my platoon. There's going to be a third one. One of them is an Army sergeant. He was like an E6 or E7, already been in 10 years or something. And he's going to OCS to get his commission.
Right.
Because he's going to be a lifer and just become an officer. He's a good man. And he was a man. He was good 10 years older than we were. He had been a boxer in the Army back when they still did that kind of thing. And one of the ways people would mess with you, and we like messing with each other, was you go in the shower and you got the hot water running, they would flush the toilets. And the plumbing was set up so that the cold water would go to the toilets, only the hot water would get to the showers. So that's all there was. So you get scalded for a few seconds. And they'd mess with you. And it happened to me a couple of times. And finally it happened the third time. I came out and said to the next SOB that does that, I'm going to come out and kick his ass.
Yeah.
So it happens again, and out I come. I'm wearing a towel and shower, you know, sandals.
Yeah.
Flip-flops. And there he is. And he's about 6'2", 220 pounds. So I decide I can't back down. Whatever happened, taking an ass whooping from the toughest guy is not as bad as backing down.
True.
So, I wasn't a fighter, but I wanted to get it over with quick. So I said, "Oh man!" and threw him an uppercut.
Yeah.
And he smiled at me.
Like a gnat biting an elephant. Yeah.
He smiled at me. And the next thing I knew, I'm on the ground. I get up, and I'm on the ground. Now, the towel is off. The shoes are off. I'm slipping on the steamed-up, wet tile floor. And he looks at me. He says, "You get up again, I'm just going to knock you back down." So that was the end of that. Here's how that becomes part of the honor code situation. He was having marital problems. He and his wife were away from each other. He'd been away before that on a duty station. They hadn't seen each other. We got a pass. You're only allowed to go 50 miles away.
Right.
She was more than 50 miles away. He went to see her. The other black guy was a New York hustler, interesting fella, went with him. They were buddies. Not hard to imagine.
Yeah.
And he went to see her. And they got back late. And a buddy said, "Look, we'll make up this story, and we'll tell him that we had car trouble and we just got in as best we could." And so they start questioning him, and the other guy tells a story about the car trouble. And the big sergeant tells the truth. He said, "I went to see my wife. I left. I violated the rule." And so they kept him in and kicked the other guy out.
Because he lied.
Honor code violation. So that's serious stuff. He got booted out. The guy that told the truth stayed in. And then maybe they wanted him in more. I don't know. And you don't know what decision. You helped make those decisions.
Yeah.
That was an honor code violation. All is going fairly well. I'm a week away from becoming a senior candidate.
Uh-huh.
my future wife is coming to town. We're having a party. We get a pass, but we got to pass this inspection, and it's a big deal inspection. You don't pass this inspection, you ain't going on. You ain't getting any leave for this weekend. You're staying here.
Mm-hmm.
Now, once you become a senior candidate, you can come and go as you please.
Right.
Is that the same thing when you were there?
No.
We could go.
They
go to town.
The senior candidates could come and go, but only with a pass.
Oh, is that right?
And the TAC officer had to sign off.
Well, I never got to be
most of the time they did.
Yeah.
But
I never got to be one is the point of the story.
Uh-huh.
So I don't know that.
Yeah.
But we had a guy who got recycled.
Yeah.
I don't know why he got another black guy, as it turned out. I spent almost my whole life working with black folks. City of Atlanta.
Yeah.
Teaching. City of Atlanta Parks and Recreation Department was always in black neighborhoods.
Mm-hmm.
Just so happened that he was pissed and he wasn't going to do what we told him to do. He was always very, very upset about getting recycled. And I understand that because you get so close to these guys, you don't want to leave them.
Yeah.
And that's going to affect me in just a minute. Because he wouldn't do what he said he was going to do, I said, oh, yeah, you are. Bang, punch, fight. Yeah. Lamp gets knocked over. A duty officer, officer of the day, just graduated.
Mm-hmm.
Was walking around the barracks from the little headquarters there were, and saw the light go down, heard the noise, comes in, what's going on, honor code, you tell them.
Right.
So what are they going to do with me? They could kick me out. Instead, they take me to a board.
Yeah.
And they say, well, what do you think? And I said, well, this is what happens. I'm sorry it happened. They said, do you think you're qualified to be an officer? Yes, sir, I do. I got a record. I'm the top half of my class. I'm real high in leadership ability.
Right.
I'd already done another dumb thing. This is how gung-ho I was. They told me I couldn't become an infantry officer because I wore glasses, but I could get an exception. If I wrote them a letter and say, I want to become an officer and I can deal with the glasses, then they'd let me become an infantry officer. Because if you lose your glasses, you can't read maps and things like that. Mine was long vision.
That's the concept, but it was a bit
so
of a
So I'd already
bowl.
Said, I'm going in infantry.
Right.
I'm going in infantry. So I was gung-ho, and they said, well, now, you can leave it up to us, but we may decide to leave you in, or we may kick you out, or you can go ahead and be recycled.
Mm-hmm.
And I was cocky, and I don't need to do that. I'm so good they're going to keep me in. I'm not going to leave my buddies. And I was wrong. So out I go.
Oh, all right.
Out I go. We're going to get to Vietnam. I ended up being sent to a basic training company. I was an acting DI. I didn't like the people I was working with. This is the only really terrible bad story I have, and again, it's not in that memoir because the memoir is only about Vietnam. Had a sergeant whose name I'll never forget. If I ever find him, he was the senior DI.
Mm-hmm.
If I ever find him in an airport anywhere, I'm gonna punch him. He was extorting.
You want my card? I'm an attorney. If you do punch him,
he was extorting money from his troopers. He did it every cycle. Yeah. He'd come in and say, oh, I'm sorry I'm so hard. And he was particularly hard on these guys, harder than my DI was on me. And he would be really mean, and he'd come and get the squad leaders together and say, I'm sorry, guys, I understand I'm doing this, but I got these problems. My wife's got medical issues. The Army won't cover it. I got these money worries, and it's making me act crazy. And so they would all volunteer like 10 bucks a piece at 40 guys. So he'd walk off with $400. And then he would not hardly show up the rest of the cycle, and his junior DIs would do the work. And I was one of them. So now they say, you're going to go to DI school. I already been to OCS, you can go to DI school. I said, no. I'm wearing acting stripes, but I'm not a brevet or whatever they call it.
Were you an E3?
At that point in time, I probably
your permanent
E3.
Grade? Yeah.
But they're going to make me a DI. I said, I'm not going to come back to these guys. And what are they going to do with me? Well, I drove the colonel of the whole training battalion or Jeep. That was my job
before
I went to Vietnam. I want to talk about a couple family members and get back so you can get back to me to get to Vietnam.
Okay. Okay.
I forgot to mention, I had an uncle, one of my daddy's brothers, who served in India in World War II.
Really?
I had an uncle who was an MP in Washington, D.C. in World War II.
Good job.
I've talked about the nuns and my dad being tougher. I was a football player, and so back then you didn't get any water, and you'd go to 2 days without water. So basic training wasn't hard for me. I got married right before I went to Vietnam.
So you stayed at Benning until you got orders to Vietnam? Okay.
No, I went Benning, basic, McClellan, back to Benning for OCS, and then the rest of my time. So I get orders to go to Vietnam. My wife, who I met on a trip back to Atlanta from Hapeville, mm-hmm. we got married. A nice lady, and we got divorced when I came back. That was probably a result of Vietnam. We no longer had anything in common. She's a nice lady. I've never said anything bad about her. This was on my head.
No kids?
No kids, yeah. Fortunately. She became very religious, and I wasn't.
Right.
I was raised Catholic, so I'm still what I call a surviving Catholic, you know. Or what's another word besides? I'm surviving, and I'm in therapy, too, from being raised Catholic in a very Catholic family, 10 kids. And it took me probably 30 or 40 years to see that which is the simplest, most plainest thing on your nose, on your face, why I got married. Because I thought I was going to die in Vietnam, I wanted somebody to love me before I died. And that's so clear and obvious. But I didn't see it for 30 or 40 years. I didn't understand.
I'm no therapist, but I think that sounds logical to me.
I was originally scheduled to go to the AmeriCal division, which mm-hmm. would have put me possibly with Cali. I was that same.
Would have put you up north further.
Yeah, and in the infantry instead of the armored cavalry.
Right. I think he was in the 198th Light Infantry Brigade, I think.
Exactly who he was. AmeriCal division.
AmeriCal division.
The 198th was down in Benning.
Yeah.
AmeriCal division.
Uh-huh.
And that's where I was sent. And
right.
I got pneumonia. I thought on my honeymoon, but really it was what I was doing before that, probably. Got the pneumonia. Went to New Orleans. My wife worked for Delta Airlines. She got us to fly places.
Uh-huh.
I went to New Orleans and got sick, couldn't breathe, which made for a very interesting honeymoon. You don't love me. Came home, went to Fort Mac Hospital.
And by Fort Mac, you're referring to Fort McPherson here in Atlanta.
Right over here, near Hapeville. I don't know if I talk about that. We'll see. The guy, as an older guy, was in an oxygen tent next to me, died that first night. So that really scared me. I had a real bad case. I was getting penicillin shots every 6 hours in the hospital. And you know how gentle Army nurses can be. It wasn't them.
Yeah.
It was a great big old horse needle. Mm-hmm. And it would go in the hip. And so it would be the left hip, the right hip, 6 hours later, the left and the right. And they knew what was coming. So if it was going to the left hip, it would punch up like this, and the right hip would be giggling. It's your turn now. The last day, they gave me pills, and that really upset me.
Yeah.
But they couldn't. They had to give you the big dose. Point of that story is, when I went over, I went unassigned. So I went to the repo depot, 93rd Repo Depot. I'll talk a little bit when I get there about that.
Give me time frame here. When did you arrive in Vietnam?
Left. Tell you what, let me read some of that. Are we into Vietnam? Am I done telling you?
I don't know.
Okay, let's go to Vietnam.
I'm not trying. I mean, if you have something.
Yeah, no, I told you everything. Told you everything that I wanted to about my family background. Unless you have questions.
No.
Family background. Okay, that's what I want to talk about at the beginning of this. So let me read some to you. Right. And it is, I think, the kind of thing. I got mostly I'm going to tell some war stories. But it's part of a lot of this is about what it was like to be in Vietnam, which you may or may not be more interested in the war stories.
Let me put it to you this way, okay? I'm interested in your story and your life
right,
and your experiences in Vietnam.
I believe you now. You've said it enough.
And I mean that.
All right, so this is
that's why we're here.
This is for my family.
All right.
And for kids coming up, and nieces and nephews. Uh-huh. My daddy was about 20 years old when he joined the U.S. Marines to fight in World War II. I have photos of him in his dress uniform and utilities and wearing a grass skirt on a South Pacific island. Cool to see my daddy in a grass skirt. He served in Iwo Jima, among other places. He and most of his best generation didn't talk about their war experiences as much as I have. I never heard his stories enough, and he probably shared some stories with each of us that not all of us know. And I found that out talking to my brothers. They knew a story I didn't know. I knew stories they didn't know. But
If I may interject something here, the reason you're here today is that we've lost the great majority of those World War II stories. We don't want to lose the Vietnam stories. So.
And they didn't tell them. Most of them didn't tell them. Some did, but I do tell them. And that's the point I wrote this. I never heard his stories enough and probably shared some stories with each of us. Remember, this is for my family, that not all of us know. I always wanted to know more. I am really not that good a storyteller, but I always had good stories to tell. I have been telling stories forever and telling these war stories for four decades. I decided to put these stories on paper just the way I have recited them so that my sons and siblings and extended family will know them all the same. As you read them, imagine me telling you the stories out loud, which we all won't be doing. So far as I can determine, they are true given their age and the fact that they named Alzheimer's after me. So to your original question, how I got there. I have photos, some of which are in here. I'll take this time to digress.
Okay.
At the back of this, I did one thing wrong. I had photos on a flash drive to bring if you wanted to look at them. But if not, at the end of this, I have photos, many of which refer to the stories I'm telling.
Okay.
And some, like I'm fixing to mention now, I have in here with photos that I brought. So this one, I says I have a photo.
Sue will talk to you about those when we get.
Okay. I have photos taken on the last day of 1967. At a combination New Year's Eve and goodbye party. The party was at the home of my then brother-in-law, Bobby, and my sister, Mary Ann. She's my younger sister. She got married in high school. At the party were friends. I'm like, you don't need their names. But one of my best friends and his future wife, and a guy and his future wife, and my best friend joined the Air Force, went to Georgia Tech. In fact, all of my best friends went to Georgia Tech. I wasn't smart enough. he went to Air Force ROTC. He was from a family of 10. I had another best friend in high school who was from a family of 10. So there's 30 kids between our three families. He went to Tech on an Air Force, got a regular commission, went in, talked for years about getting out, kept getting promotions, came out 26 years later as a bird colonel. And basically his job then was satellite intelligence. So he was the real deal. He didn't serve in combat. He served in, his only foreign duty station was Iceland. That wasn't bad duty.
Yeah, really.
He used to tell his wife there was a pretty girl behind every tree in Iceland. And there weren't any trees.
There aren't any trees, yeah.
you know the story.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So those people were at the party. And then I'm talking about my friend Ron, who was there. He and I were at McClellan together. He went to OCS before I did. He got out before I did, finished, went to Pathfinder School, got an incurable skin disease in the jungles of Panama at Pathfinder School, and never had to go to Vietnam. Lost touch with him. And then I tell the story about the Army Chemical School that I told you and about the rec center fight, but we're getting back to going there. Talking about what it was like to be at McClellan, small, you know, for a young man, it was actually fun. Now I'm in before a show I'm going about McClellan. But it said basically it was fun. You got to run around with machine guns and mortars and, you know, playing soldier. And we went to OCS. After OCS, I did all that. Now I'm getting ready to go. And those photos from New Year's Eve, the one person who could not even pretend to be having a good time was my first wife, Gail. We had only been married 7 weeks, and I spent 3 weeks of that in the hospital at Fort McPherson or recovering from pneumonia. I'd actually gotten sick in the Army before the wedding, so I told you all that story. Gail had to go through all of that with me and the pneumonia and in the hospital, and then still, instead of me going a couple of days later from when I got sick, she had to wait another 7 weeks. Mm-hmm. Which is tough on her, is essentially the point. It took a worse toll on her than me. Sitting and waiting at home is worse, and now she had an extra 6 weeks to be nervous. It shows in those photos. She is sitting in a pink plaid pantsuit, her posture rigid with a weak forced smile on her face, and eyes that look like tears are fighting their way out while she exerts her will to hold them back. So I'm reading this because I couldn't remember how to say that. Mm-hmm. Extemporaneously. Now, it might be better extemporaneously, but I wanted to say it.
I'll leave it
January 1st, I left. 1968, I got on the plane. The most momentous year in baby boomer history to go to Fort Dix, New Jersey. The truth is, Gail had the most reason to be worried. Without being morbid, I was at peace with the fact that I was probably going to die over there. Being pessimistic can result in self-fulfilling prophecy. I wanted to survive and had every intention of doing so in my power to return in one piece. Going over there in a yet-to-be-decided combat unit, the odds were simply not in my favor. The result was that instead of being petrified and unable to function, it was liberating. It gave me the freedom to act without abnormal fear and perform as I was trained and let fate take its course. I was still experiencing shakes and shivers during the fighting. We had one particular battle that was like a World War II battle that I want to talk about. But what I didn't
during
say,
Tet or before?
After Tet.
After Tet.
I was involved in Tet, and I'll talk about that. But I can remember my legs shaking the whole time mm-hmm. because we're going to it. We know we're going to get there. We know what's going to be there when we get there. It was a fixed battle, which we almost never got into. They ran away from us.
Right.
You know, we just had too much firepower. But this one, they didn't run. So I was scared.
So did you come into Long Bend or Benoit? Or Tontonute?
Tontonute. One of my pictures in here is a Tontonute air base from a distance during a firefight we had in the Tet Offensive. First big firefight. When I went in the Army on July 5th, 1966, that was my entry date into the Army, July 5th, 1966. Let's talk some more about basic training. We're doing stream of consciousness. We were backed up. People that went on the 3rd and 4th, or the 3rd or 2nd of July, didn't get processed the way they normally would because the Army took the days off. July 4th, July 5th, I think was a Sunday, or 4th was a Sunday, and so they took off Saturday and Sunday, and these guys weren't getting processed. So we had to wait. All those people that arrived 2 days and 1 day before us got processed for us. So we did the whole bit of getting the haircuts. I had long hair then. I was trying to grow it. I was already losing my hair. My daddy gave us burr haircuts. He had a pair of Sears clippers. He tried to cut it, right? But the breeze would make you shake, and he'd cut out. And he had to just cut it off. He charged me $1.25 for a haircut. And my hair was already cut shorter than they were going to cut it. That really made me mad. I made $90 a month. We stood out the first meal I ever had in the Army. The first day, we stood in the sun in these brand new hot wool uniforms, wool socks, and it was 90-something degrees. And we just, not in the shade, just standing in parade formation to get into the mess hall. When we got in there, the food was gone. The ice was gone. All they had to feed us was mashed potatoes and fried bologna and a glass of water, warm water. and hot in that mess hall. And either they oversalted all of them, or I got a portion of the mashed potatoes that had way too much salt in it. I couldn't eat them. So I ate the fried bologna, I drank the water, and I'm sitting there leaning over like this with the sweat pouring off my face into the potatoes. So I took my spoon and made like a volcano center and filled it up with sweat dropping off my head into the hole in the mashed potatoes. That was my first meal in the Army. It got better. Army food was better after that. You got chocolate milk, all the chocolate milk you could drink, and all the food. So I eat better in the Army than I did at home. 10 kids, we were always hungry.
Yeah.
So that was my first day in the Army. But when I first went in, now I'm back, it's Christmas. I got to stay for Christmas in 1967 that I otherwise wouldn't have if I hadn't gotten pneumonia. I was paid all of $90 a month. I never had so much money. I always enjoyed giving Christmas presents to my family more than getting them. I took pride in trying to find something personal for each one with the limited money I had. $90 a month was more than enough. Christmas gave me a chance to really feel good about the presents I could give. The desire to do something special for my family was shared then as now by all of us. Excuse me. That's a tough sentence for me. I was afraid I was going to do this out in the car. I'm the oldest of 10, but there's only 5 of us left. So that's tough.
Yeah.
But I was going to be home for Christmas 67. But because of my hospital stay and recuperation leave, I was able to go all out that year. In my mind, it might be the last good memory my family would have of me should I not come back. I only remembered one of those presents. Joey was very special to me because he was my youngest brother and the most joyous, happy personality, and because he was my godson. I bought him an electric football game where tiny little players moved around on thin metal board due to the electrical current. Y'all,
I remember absolutely. I remember.
And I bought model airplane paint and used it to paint uniforms with tiny little stripes on the helmets. I probably never worked so long on a project requiring more patience and attention to detail. And just knowing I had done that still gives me satisfaction. So I leave the next day, New Year's Day. Fort Dix was reached by way of Philadelphia, where I visited historical sites, caught a bus to the base, where we were issued jungle fatigues that were just Army perfect for the 10-degree temps outside, but appropriate for our arrival. We flew on a chartered commercial jet to Alaska to refuel. It was warmer than it was in New Jersey. The two guys I sat with and would frequently start humming or singing a new Beatles song, You Say Hello, I Say Goodbye. So that was perfect for saying hello to Vietnam and goodbye to the world. And one of us would start, and the other three of us would join in. We did that all through the trip. Of the three of us, I was the only one going to a combat unit. We flew over the lights of Japan for what seemed like hours. It was nighttime, and all you could see was lights under. This would be our last fueling stop before a much shorter trip to Vietnam to land at Tansanud Air, the largest base in country. They ushered us off in a hurry to quickly reload with guys going home. They did not refuel because it took too long to withdraw enemy rocket attacks trying to hit us on the runway. The plane that delivered us immediately became the most sacred icon in country, the Freedom Bird.
Freedom Bird.
Waiting to board were hundreds of American war heroes going home, some very few in civvies, some in Class B khakis, and some in dust-covered jungle uniform. What catcalls they gave us, what graphic warnings, what cheers and jeers, and what heartfelt good wishes. I don't know what trepidation my face revealed. Fear and excitement and curiosity were visible on my companions' faces. Not until the day I left have I ever seen such pure joy as the departing faces showed. Their faces shined with light, Some had tears in their eyes, and some were looking apprehensive and probably would until they got out of range of the enemy. I cut a picture out of the internet that I keep with my pictures showing a plane of guys going, a picture of guys on an army plane going on,
yeah.
Not a commercial one. What do we experience on the tarmac? Bright white light. Stop you in your track, blast furnace heat with steam bath humidity that had us sweating in seconds. Welcome to Vietnam. We were loaded on buses and were driven through Benoit, one of the largest cities, where we were all nervous since we were unarmed and had heard so many stories about terror attacks. The only protection was wire mesh on the windows to prevent hand grenades from flying through the glass. We saw our first glimpse of masked humanity. There were old people with blackened teeth from chewing, I think it's betel nut, or Bechdel nut all their lives. Girls wore long white pants covered by long white shirts. Young men looked like 1950s teen hoods, wearing all black with slicked black hair. Many of them rode small Japanese motorcycles. There were thousands of Vespa-type three-wheeled motorcycles that could be configured to carry passengers and everything from ducks and geese to heavy lumber. Everything was exotic and seemed as congested as Times Square on New Year's Eve. Mingling with the crowd were Viet police and local militias or regional forces who we called Rough Puffs, or RF. There were MPs and American servicemen and regular Viet soldiers, all of whom were armed, many with old World War II rifles. There were many military jeeps and trucks. Mama Sans and straw hats worked the stalls, selling anything you might think, from Coca-Colas to cameras to guns to 33. The local beer, that was the name of it, 33. The food items I still don't recognize. Little kids ran around barefoot or often half or totally naked. They begged from all Americans. There was advertising in Vietnamese and French and English and in some parts of town, Chinese. That was called Cholan area. We ended up there in Tet. There were a few old men. There are very few men older than teenagers or younger than Papa San's, and many of those you saw were missing limbs. We slowly wound our way into the 90th replacement depot or repo depot. Here we put in barracks until we went through the process of being assigned. All right. My MOS was 11 Bravo Infantry. Oh, Lord. So where am I going? The first night we heard bombing raids from B-52s that really do sound like rolling thunder, with light bouncing off the clouds that you could see and hear from a long ways away and brightening the horizon. This first night was spent worried about sapper attacks while we were all unarmed. You didn't probably need to worry. The next day I was called.
No, if they got there, it wouldn't have made any difference if you had a weapon or not, if they attached the sapper charge to your barracks.
Well, the next day I was called to be interviewed by the 11th Armored Cavalry. Apparently they had seen something in my records that made me a candidate to be recruited for their long-range recon patrol, LRRP, L-R-R-P. Stands for long-range reconnaissance. LRRPs were basically scouts who performed many other missions, such as checking out bombing raid results, going on rescue missions for downed airplanes or helicopters, and ambush missions. This was on a voluntary basis only. They all together were a 28-man platoon. We got to carry special weapons, such as a CAR 15, which is a shortened version of an M16.
Short barrel,
short stock. And it had decreased weight and increased mobility. You could move it around better. And it had a very high coolness factor. Nobody else got to carry it.
And it doesn't jam as much as the M16.
I didn't know that at the time.
I carried one for 18 months.
Okay. We also got to carry our own sidearms, such as shotguns and .357 Magnums. Only this unit got to carry them in the cab. We also had our own hooches and a very slack attitude about typical military BS. They're the only unit that got to wear a black beret during my time, with a corresponding very high coolness factor. I figured if you're going to be there, do it right with a special unit, so I did that which everyone knows not to do, which is volunteer. Later that day, I took my first chopper ride and a big Chinook to Black Horse Base Camp. Everything was covered in red dust, including the troopers. Except for a few guys, everyone was on the Cambodian border and the Parrot's Beak region of Tainan province.
Let me ask you a question. First of all, which squadron were you with?
Second squadron. Okay, right. We're going to ask this. E-Troop, 2nd Platoon, E-Troop, 2nd Squadron.
And where was their base camp?
From Swanlock.
In Swanlock.
They've been another base camp before, but mine was Swanlock.
So that would have been southeast of Benoit Base Camp.
Yes.
Okay.
On the road to get anywhere, we had to go through Swanlock.
Right.
We had to go through Swanlock. I spent a night in Swanlock. I don't think I was going to put this in there. I spent one night in Swanlock before the big pitched battle I'm going to tell you about.
Uh-huh.
And we were there basically to provide security for a group of American women. I don't remember who they were. They were round eyes. But they were either donut dollies or Red Cross or UFO,
yeah.
USO entertainers. We got to see them for maybe a minute as they got out of the buses. But they were in a compound, and we were set up as security around. Never saw them again.
For the record, Swanlock is spelled X-U-A-N, second word, L-O-C.
L-O-C, Swanlock. Okay. Yeah, X is pronounced as S's over there,
yeah.
Swanlock.
Uh-huh.
So I spent the next day getting gear and training for Vietnam in general and LRPS in particular, zeroing in our new weapons and practice using demolitions and cover and concealment and camouflage, radio protocol, rappelling out of copters, which I never did. In real situation, we never did
right.
that. The purpose was we would also do LRP standard operating procedures and tactics and even lessons on eating Nook Moi sauce, which is basically fish guts spread over rice.
Yes.
And the idea was you would smell like them in the jungle. We would smell different to them because we ate so much meat that they didn't eat. So we would try to be the best we could. That was one of the factors about being in this group I was with. We tried to be the best we could be.
By the way, a little footnote to that is that that sauce also keeps the water buffalo from thinking that you're an intruder.
Oh, is that right?
The water buffalo pick up on that odor too. That
was, see, I'm learning stuff here.
Yeah.
All right. I didn't know that.
Told me by a MACV advisor.
Yep. So, where am I at? It was not bad if you held your nose while eating it. The purpose is okay. Twice during those few days, we went out on night ambush patrols. It was practice. Mm-hmm. That while part of our training, and then that was supposed to give us a real part, besides our training, we were part of the defense mechanism protecting the base camp. And I went out on a number of those, a couple I'm going to talk about. After this, the four new guys and one of the experienced NCOs training with us flew by copter to the Cambodian border where the entire regiment was located. So we did the training, went to the Cambodian border. That would have been January 6th, January 7th, I'm thinking.
Where
I went to the Cambodian border.
What area of the Cambodian border?
The Parrot's Beak area.
Okay.
Parrot's Beak.
I know where you are. Okay.
Kind of
west of Kuchi.
Yeah. And it looks like this jumping into Cambodia.
Right.
So they could come in from either side and escape.
Right.
Actually went into Vietnam.
So it was an infiltration point of the Ho Chi Minh Trail.
Exactly right. Why we were there. So I'm mentioning, this is just a side story that you may not want to hear, but after the second day being in the jungle out there, I've been going commando ever since. Your underwear rotted off you.
And it did.
It just rotted off because it was cotton, and the fatigues were nylon-ish or something that supposed to get the water off you, the sweat off you. So I've been commando ever since then, except when I go to the doctor or somewhere else where people might be offended. The Fishhook is an area where Cambodia juts into Vietnam and shaped like its name implies. It was a place where the Ho Chi Minh Trail emptied into RVM, Republic of Vietnam. I may use that again. It's easier to type. Where the North Vietnamese could infiltrate south, north, and east. there had been major battles around the city of Tainan and Lucknow the previous month, and the 11th ACR was there to stop them. Our LERP platoon was sent out in small five-man units to observe and report along the NVA's entry points. At this point in time, we're still in Vietnam.
So this would have been mid-January 1968. Pre-Tet.
Around the 7th, 8th, 9th, okay. In that area. I was with him for 3 weeks.
Okay.
Total. And I'll tell you why I got out.
Okay.
Over the next 3 days, we went out on four missions, including two that lasted a little over 48 hours and one that lasted less than 8 hours. That was because they inserted us very close to another patrol that was discovered just after our insertion. The NVA sent several units towards our guys, thinking they knew where they were, and their closest extraction point was where we had landed. So we went back and set up a defensive position to protect both the LZ and them when they worked their way back into the clearing, this other five-man team. We all managed to get out without getting hurt. My fourth and last mission was a while later. They're starting to change the mission, and they stopped sending us out, and they weren't finding anything. My fourth and last mission was in Cambodia to set up by a trail junction in Cambodia, I'm told. That's one of those things that, I don't know. But they said you're in Cambodia.
It was something off your map.
Yeah. The Ho Chi Minh Trail at this point was more like a highway covered by triple canopy jungle from above. If we could find enough of them, our job was to report it, get out, and let someone above our pay grade make sense of it. We didn't see very many. We counted less than a dozen over 3 days we were on this mission. Those were the first actual enemy I would see in the open, and it would be late April, maybe March, I don't know why I wrote April, before I saw the VC again, and it was another recon patrol. It would be that before I saw the VC again. You didn't see him in the open. I was one of the two times, maybe three, that I actually saw enemy soldiers that when I was in country. They didn't want to be seen. Not by us, anyway.
Yeah.
This was a memorable mission, this last one, for two incidents. We were dropped about 2 miles from our assigned location and walked in from there. It's probably two clicks, or maybe 2 miles. You want to get as far away so they don't know you're in there.
Yeah, probably a couple of clicks.
Choppers would fly very low over the jungle because you'd be by somebody before they even knew you were there. If you fly up high, they can see you coming and hear you coming from a long way.
Got time to lead you.
So we were dropped. Fine. We didn't rappel. We just got out of the helicopter on a little opening. And thick jungle in Cambodia, where we were really not allowed to be, it was a long and slow and careful trek that we made to get where we were supposed to be, with heavy doses of fear mitigated by heavy doses of adrenaline. It was on this route that we came to a very small clearing, about the size of a small gym. Even this small an area needed to be skirted rather than crossed in the open. On this mission, I was second in line behind the point man and was carrying one of two PRC 25 radios we carried. It's a big, heavy, probably weighed 25 pounds. It is a heavy and awkward radio, but a vital lifeline, which is why we carried two with extra batteries. The point man stopped at the clearing and froze. He motioned me up, and there I saw what had caused him to stop. On the other side of the clearing, perhaps only 20 yards away, was a tiger entering the clearing very slowly. I had a rush of emotions. The first was the pure awe at the beauty and majesty of this young tiger with his muscles rippling up under his fur. And he stepped out into the sunlight. The next emotion was fear. I really did not want to be killed and eaten by this tiger. No matter how beautiful he was. Uh-huh. My next fear was wondering if we could even shoot him before he could bound a couple of strides and pounce on us. My last fear was that even if we could bring him down, the sound of M16 gunfire, which is distinctively different than an AK-47 fire, would surely bring the NVA to us.
Right.
The tiger either saw us or smelled us, and he stopped and looked at us for what was probably only a few seconds, but seemed like to take forever. And then he slowly and regally turned around and walked away. That was the first of the incident. The second incident that marked this mission occurred on the hike back to our extraction point. We were actually on a small trail, which normally we would not travel on, but we were late and it was getting dark. I was again walking behind the point man when our trail intersected another trail, and the point man actually bumped shoulders with an NVA soldier who had emerged from his back left position. So he's walking this way. From our back left is a trail intersecting this one, and they bump shoulders. I didn't see this.
Yeah.
I never saw the guy. I think I say that.
Did a firefight break out?
Yes. Both of them were startled and just looked at each other before fumbling for their rifles. And I say it, despite the fact that I was only a few steps behind, I never did see the enemy. One of these two started shooting, then so did the rest of us. We DD-mowed out of there.
DD-mow is to run like hell.
Yeah.
That's what DD-mow
means. DD-mow was an American use. Just get the hell out of here. Yeah.
Right.
I'm a teacher, so
right.
Yeah. And you know this stuff. Mm. Both sides fired, but no one was hit until the guy behind me sprayed the jungle with automatic fire from left to right in the direction of their fire and did not see. And this happens. You do not see things. Talking about the looking through the straw. This is perfect here. A great big damn tree. And so he's shooting the tree. And he got hit by one of his own ricocheted bullets. Hit the tree and it bounced back and hit him. That wasn't a terrible wound, but he was bleeding. He was in pain.
I wouldn't recommend it.
No. So we had to half drag the wounded guy and try to hurry in the almost darkness, knowing full well that we were going to regroup and get reinforcements and to come after us. We were only a quarter mile from our pickup LZ, so we got on the horn to make sure they knew we needed them to arrive just as we did, so that neither of us would, and the copter would be in the clearing for very long. The wounded man would survive and return to combat. In a short time, he was the only injured man we had when I was in that unit. We weren't John Wayne. I'm going to say that somewhere. Within the next 2 days, the whole platoon of by then 25 of us were called to meet the regiment second in command, who explained they were going to change our mission from LERP unit to what became an ARP, or Aero, A-E-R-O, rifle platoon. Aero meaning we're going to fly in helicopters. It would have had many of the same missions, but also would have had us going out on copters as a reaction force and dropping into hot LZs.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't want nothing to do with that, which they were already under fire. We would go out in very large 40-man ambush patrols. This would be a volunteer special unit. In all caps, no thank you. Jumping off a copter while taking fire is not anything I wanted to be part of. We worked hard at being prepared and diligent as we could, and still it was hard to get just five of us to be silent enough to move quietly through the jungle. Something's rattling. You're stepping on a branch. It was not possible for 40 people to do it quietly. Our mission was to sneak and peek and count, not to be John Wayne. The new mission was to require us to be Rambo. Didn't know that at the time. I knew John Wayne at the time, but Rambo came later. The new ARP was created without me and became the most decorated unit in the CAV, but at a very high cost, including 15 KIA over the course of the war. Shortly after the CAV realized that they still needed, a LERP team and reinstated the Union, all without Al, I am happy to report. Duke. So Al didn't go. Al got out of there. It didn't mean he got out of there. Another short trip on a resupply copter took me to the 2nd Platoon of E Troop, 2nd Squadron, 11th Regiment, Black Horse. A cavalry troop is the same as an infantry company, and the squadron of cavalry is the same as an infantry battalion, and a regiment is an infantry brigade. We're not even called soldiers, we're called troopers. So some differences. I was doing some research on music just the other day. You flew in choppers, and you were in the 1st Infantry, and of course the 7th Regiment, Cavalry's Regiment, is the focus of the story about we were soldiers once and young.
Yeah, that's right.
And I found a song, and it is an older song, maybe going back to the days of the original horse cavalry, which the 11th Armored Cavalry was. 11th Armored Cavalry, I write about it, but it was the
Gary Owens. Yeah. Is that
well, that
the
was
song?
Seventh. That was seventh. But all cavalry sort of adopt that song.
Right.
Anyway, it was if I have to go to war, I want to join the cavalry.
Right.
And I just found that song within the last 3 days. So we were cavalry and not infantry. When I got there, it didn't seem that I got out of there. A cavalry troop is the same. I read all that. A troop has 3 platoons of 8 armored personnel carriers, there's also a headquarters platoon, which includes a larger tracked vehicle set up for better and longer range radio communication. It also, headquarters also includes several large mortars mounted inside the M113 carrier, which is M113 is the nomination of it. But then it became the M114. The first ones went over were steel. They sank in the mud up to the top. Mm-hmm. They changed them to be an aluminum. They didn't protect you very well. Then they were called M114s. They were originally designed to carry men on a combat assault, and the armored vehicle could protect them from our own artillery as we got closer in a World War II type attack. Protect from small arms fire anyway. And I talk about the M14. Pretty much, and weighed 10 tons less. So we had 2 M60 machine guns on it, rear with gun shields. We had a cupola that protected the track commander. And he had a 50 caliber machine gun, a kind of an electrically operated cupola that would go around. 50 caliber is a big, heavy weapon. I'm telling people who know, but some people might not. Man, you could throw it and kill somebody if you hit them in the right place with it. It was so big. It chopped down trees. Mm. It was accurate to 2,000 yards. So we had that plus 2 M60 machine guns. We were supposed to have a loader, original TOE, table of organization and equipment. It means we were supposed to have 5, but we never did.
We
most ever had 4. A driver, a commander, 2 gunners. They're supposed to be a loader, but we never got one of them. An infantry platoon, if you're in the infantry, with 40 men, would normally carry 2 M60s known as pigs. If every member of the platoon carried 200 round bandoliers, you know, like Mexican bandits, you would carry them. You could maybe get 8,000 rounds for those 2 guns with 40 people carrying 200 rounds each. That's how you get the 80,000, 8,000. On our vehicles, we would carry 10,000 rounds of M60 ammunition and 5,000 rounds of 50 caliber ammunition. To make a long story short, we had the firepower of a World War II battalion, which is why the enemy didn't want to mess with us too much, all that massive firepower behind armor. Black Horse saw more firefights in combat than any other similar size unit in the Republic of Vietnam. And that was because we went to where the fight was. That was our job. We were responders. Or we would go into the jungle and try to knock down the jungle to find the enemy in the jungle. Still a whole lot better than being in the infantry. My unit from 66 to 72... and there were 50,000 men killed in action in Vietnam. We lost 703 of them, KIA.
Mm-hmm.
That's 1.5% of the total in Vietnam came from our unit. Every man in my platoon had at least 1 Purple Heart. I had 3. That was not unusual. But 3 was a little unusual, but everybody
3
had
is unusual.
2.
I...
Yeah. How lucky can you be?
How unlucky can you be?
Well, depending on your perspective.
I never met anybody that said, gee, I hope I get a Purple Heart.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Well, I just said that in here, so I am doing it. I am now a member of the 11th Armored Cavalry Regiment Veterans of Vietnam. So that's where I got this shirt. This is my association. We meet every year. We met a few years ago in Las Vegas. They're doing it again in Las Vegas. My wife got physical problems and can't travel, so I won't be going this year. I find it hard to believe how all those beautiful young men have become old, bald men, excluding my handsome daddy, Boemker self, of course. When I see them, as I did in Las Vegas in 2014, I call them all by the name I always thought of them as being my brother. And that's how we treat each other. Hey, brother. I have read in many places the quotes of high-ranking officers that referred to us as the most effective combat unit to serve in the Republic of Vietnam. Looking at it as objectively as possible, that evaluation is probably accurate. And I talked about it. We were the most effective, but let's be clear here. We are not the smartest or the bravest or the most professional or the most dedicated, nor do we have it the worst or suffer the most. Because we had the most firepower, and because we often worked with tank companies in the regiment, and because we were used frequently as reactionary forces, we found ourselves encountering the enemy on our terms. The 39th colonel of the regiment was George S. Patton Jr. Yes, that one. We adopted his motto, which was "Find the bastards and pile on." That became kind of the unit crest. I'm cutting through stuff.
He and I were wounded the same day.
Is that right?
We're in the aid station.
That you'll remember.
Aid station at Lycay.
I'm talking about being a tip of the spear, and I'm cutting through a little bit. But one of the things that started the Vietnam War, supposedly, was I'm a history teacher, so I put this in here, but it applies to our unit, was the USS Maddox, the Gulf of Tonkin incident, in which it ended up, make a long story short, we ended up shooting at each other because somebody got in between us that was apparently an enemy PT boat or something, and this ship shot at it, and that ship shot at it, and the next thing you know, they're shooting at each other. Well, they would do that to us in Vietnam. You're in the jungle, it's thick, you can't see 10 yards away. They get a sniper or somebody popping up out of a hole, and you shoot at this unit, shoot at that unit, and next thing you know, you're shooting at each other. So we had that sort of thing happen to us on a number of times. It could be a platoon or a squad unit or even a single sniper or 1VC that would do this to you. I mentioned this. In really thick jungle, our units got 10 yards away. They couldn't see. This tells me the kind of pressure under those situations that young officers, often 20, 21 years old, had.
Right.
Again, this is very personal. And I didn't put this in for my family. I felt bad about not taking the recycle in Vietnam. I didn't for a long time. I didn't want to, but that was like a failure. I didn't complete it, and I should have, and I could have. And should have, would have, could have don't mean anything.
Well.
Until I got to Vietnam. And then I saw what these young officers had to do. And I want to talk about it just a little bit later, but I can do it now. Eventually, I became a sergeant. At one point in time, I became the platoon sergeant for a short period of time. And I didn't like it. I didn't want it. That's incredible stress. As simple as taking a left turn instead of a right turn. As simply as rolling over a mine. One of my injuries was from a mine.
Mm-hmm.
The one I told you about that hit the front of it. And I said nobody got hurt but the guy at the shoulder, but I got my eardrums blown out that day. And there's a fun story about that, but I didn't want to make those decisions. I was 21 years old and people were looking for me. And so here you are as an officer, you understand. And even worse than that, in terms of making me feel bad, and this hurt, was realizing even years after Vietnam, then the Army was right and I was wrong. I needed to go back to learn how to deal with people better. It took me a long time to come to the grips. They were right to say, no, if you don't want it bad enough to go back, we don't want you. And of course, that's part of the part of OCS, as you know, talking to an expert, is to weed out those who aren't good enough, who don't want it, who aren't capable. It's a weeding out process. They want you to quit there until you're leading 43 men in a platoon in the jungle of Vietnam. That's not the time to quit. Right. That's not the time to not be able to deal with pressure. And so I found out in Vietnam, maybe if I'd have got those bars, I'd have been cocky as I thought I was.
Until you got into combat. And then all of that changes.
Yeah. Well, you know, you got to take care of your people.
You do.
And I'm going to talk about a platoon.
More than yourself.
Yes.
You take care of your own people.
Yes. Right. Anyway, let me roll on. I don't want to talk about some of this stuff. Try not to.
So was your base camp, and I realize you were mech. I've never quite understood why the Army made a distinction between mechanized infantry and cavalry. I don't get it. It's the same thing.
We were supposed to be scouts, and they maybe rode in the back. Maybe that was what mechanized infantry was. I don't know of any true mechanized infantry units, or they just rode on top.
Yeah, there were some mech infantry units over there, not down where you and I were, but there were mech infantry units.
I guess because we came from a horse cavalry background.
Maybe.
We were called cavalry.
Right.
That's the difference, by the way, between a cavalryman and a dragoon in the old Napoleon Army.
Uh-huh.
A cavalryman were the sabers and short rifles.
Uh-huh.
A dragoon didn't have the long sabers, and they carried a longer rifle. So they were infantrymen riding on horses as opposed to cavalrymen with swords riding on horses.
It always struck me as a distinction without significance.
There you go, a distinction without a difference. Absolutely.
Right. Yeah.
We were fortunate enough during my time because most of our top leadership in the Black Horse seemed to be knowledgeable and experienced. Our most famous and outstanding, I think that's the right way to say it, regimental commander was Colonel George S. Patton, Jr. He looked like his daddy, and from all accounts I have researched, he went out of his way to be professional. He had to live up to his daddy, and he worked harder than most to measure up to his famous family heritage. He measured up, in our opinion. I say there's another story, but there's a real quick story about him, and I wasn't going to read. We were out in breaking jungle, and there were red ant nests up in the trees, and they came down on us, and we're getting bitten by thousands of red ants. And you're beating on them, and they get inside your clothes, and they have big welts, and they sting like a damn bee bite. And we're finally, what are you going to do? You're laughing and carrying on, and we're on the radio talking to each other. I got 17 reds. I killed 23 reds. Meanwhile, Patton is on our frequency.
He thinks you're killing VC.
And he figured out what was going on. And he came down and landed his helicopter. He came and talked to us and laughed with us.
Right.
A lot of other colonels would have, hey, radio protocol, young troopers.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of stuff. He wasn't like that at all, at least in that day.
He was a stud. I actually kidded him a little bit when we were at the aid station there because it was his foot that got, he had it sitting outside the chopper and a mortar round came in, enemy mortar round came in and came up through the bottom of his shoe and so it injured his foot. And so he was in there I was in there at the same time and I said, well, sir, I've heard a lot about, it's a pleasure to meet you, I've heard a lot about your father. I heard he never got hit. And so he said, well, I wasn't as good as my father.
I have never heard that story.
Yeah.
I'm learning lots of stuff here. We in the 11th ACR were mobile, and we were able to respond quickly when American units did get ambushed or encountered enemy forces. When the enemy was found, we would pile on in unmatched firepower and amass large body counts. Since this was not a war about conquering and holding territory, the measuring stick of success was the from the Pentagon on down was body counts. On several instances, my platoon was tasked to go back to the battlefield and try to count bodies. This meant finding there quickly dug mass graves and digging them up. We would take a piece of cloth and soak it in diesel fuel and tie it around our noses to mask the smell. We had to go to the graves to count body parts. If we found more right arms and left arms than there were torsos, we would push up the body count. Didn't have to do that too much, but it's very memorable. Although I had been in country for almost a month, I was considered an FNG by the members of 2nd Platoon E Troop.
You don't have to translate that one.
That meant I was a rookie or a newbie or a greenhorn or a trainee or a probationer. See, I didn't have to tell that.
I wanted you to tell it.
A lot of euphemisms for FNG, right?
Let's just say NG stands for new guy and let them figure out the rest
of it. So they were called FNG with all the lack of respect that name implies. As far as they were concerned, my previous time in the jungle did not count, and I was going to have to learn their culture and their way of doing things. I have dozens of photos I personally took and have seen thousands more of my unit and others in Vietnam, as well as hours of documentaries on the war, and I feel like I know everyone in them. And I do. I see him. I know him. That's my brother. Uh-huh. You know, I wasn't the same unit, wasn't the same year. I know you. We experienced the same things. But despite many shared experience, the truth is that every small unit has its own culture, their own shared history of where they had been and who made it and who didn't, that was particular to them alone. I had to fit into and adapt to that culture, and unknown to me, I had to do it fast because the game changer was only a few days away. Tet, 1968.
All right.
So I'm trying to do this chronological. Tet was, I don't need to pull, you, I don't need to tell them about Tet. Somebody, somewhere.
Al.
Can we take a break?
Absolutely.
Take a break. I'm sorry, but...
Okay. On camera.
Okay. Earlier, you were talking about Echo Troop, and when you came from the LERP units back with a line, what I call a line unit. I mean, that's infantry / artillery talk. But when you rejoined an actual cav troop on the ground that were a reaction force, were you still at Swan Lock Base Camp, or had they located somewhere else?
No, I operated out of Swan Lock Base Camp the short period of time I was alert.
Right.
But then when I joined my final troop, they were on the Cambodian border.
And that would have been at the Parrot's Beak, I think you said.
At the Parrot's Beak area.
Okay.
No. So actually, they sent me back to base camp.
Right.
It's why I only went on 4 missions. They sent me back to base camp and decided what to do with me, and then sent me back out from the base camp to the E troops. They had to decide who I was going to go with, what unit needed me, and then I went out. So when I joined them, we were in Tay Nam province. And what we found out was the reason I didn't find anything, I mean, we hardly saw any soldiers. We didn't see anything. We didn't see them carrying heavy equipment, nothing. That was good. But it turned out the reason we didn't see anything
that
is
they were already there.
Infiltrated.
Right.
They were already outside the gates of Binh Hoa and Saigon and every place else they were going to attack. When that happened, and I'm going to paraphrase some of this, maybe do it quicker, they brought us from Tay Ninh into the big cities, Saigon and Binh Hoa, and they lined us up, and from front to back, it was 60 miles long. You know, we had 12, well, the 3 squadrons, each of which with 4 sets of companies or troops in them.
Battalion-sized unit.
Right. Plus we had 12 tank companies, dozens of self-propelled large artillery guns, our own helicopters, a total of 288 platoons of 8 each. So we were pretty big. We operated in very small units. Almost very rarely was it more than 1 platoon at a time operating. We would work with infantry. A platoon of us, a company of infantry. So we frequently worked with infantry. And we would go weeks or months without seeing other people in our troop. So 2nd platoon would be operating on its own most of the time. But we were all together up on the Cambodian border. And it stretched from front to back 60 miles long.
Yeah, I believe that.
Get us into Binh Hoa. That's where we went, was Binh Hoa. Other people went into Saigon. Big fights in the Sholon region, the Chinese section of Saigon. The cabin fought it, not me.
Yeah, my unit fought starting at the water plant at Two Duck down highway, the at the Newport Bridge, and down into Saigon, ultimately in Tonsonute Airfield.
Yeah.
So we were fighting in the city too, and I don't know about your unit, but we weren't prepared for city fighting. We had not been trained and hadn't been I was pretty experienced combat soldier at that time, but my unit had been mostly in the jungle out in the field, and you were the same.
Yeah, I actually never fought in the city either. I'm fixing to tell my first big battle was in a village, but nothing like Saigon.
Yeah, nothing like a city.
Nothing like Saigon. So we're 60 miles, and at the very tail end of it is E Troop. The very tail end of E Troop is 2nd Platoon. The very end of the 2nd Platoon is Track 22, and that was Larry and Kay's oldest baby boy, his first baby boy. That was me sitting backward with my machine guns facing to the rear.
Were you on the 50?
Who were they going to attack? The rear of the unit.
Were you on the 50?
No, I was on a tail gunner back then.
Oh, the tail
side gunner.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So we get into where we're going to be, Saigon, and we get a call on the radio that one of our other part of our unit is involved in a possible big firefight in a village. The story is I don't know where that is. The story is that they were going to surrender, and that when the cav came, they weren't going to surrender us because we were such badasses. Now, that's probably not true.
As long as you believed you were,
that's
better.
Probably not
that's
true.
As good as being
truth
a badass.
It was probably a setup from the beginning to ambush us.
Right.
So we pull into the village, and it's a small village of grass huts.
Do you happen to remember the name of the village?
I do not.
Okay.
I do not.
All
I
right.
wish I did. But, you know, unless you're reading the maps and you're at the top of the pyramid, you don't know where you are.
Right.
You know, you're talking about War Zone D. I know a lot about it now, but I didn't know back then. I didn't know what War Zone D was when I was serving there.
I understand.
So we pull into the village. We started off the day by going to get ice. They had ice plants all over, and we could carry them. So we had ice coolers, and we could go to these. Now, you couldn't drink it. It wasn't potable. It had, you see, oil in it and bugs, but you could put your drinks on to keep it cold. And we put our beer in there, and we got a lot of beer. We got issued basically a six-pack a day a man to drink, to stay hydrated. And you learned what was good beer and what was bad beer. You know, Lone Star and PBR are the worst. So we had beer in it. And some of us had started drinking. And you didn't get drunk. You sweated it right out. But one guy, I'm going to name Child from Alabama, of the Alabama Childs, had too many. So he's on the platoon leader's track. And the platoon leader has a tough job. He's on three radio networks. He's talking to his own driver. So he's got to communicate to his driver that way. He's communicating to the rest of the platoon, and he's on radio frequency with the squadron commanders, whoever's overseeing this thing.
Right.
So he's on the radio talking to the squadron commander about what's going on, and Young opens up with his machine gun. And they're saying, don't shoot off to the left. This is where our people are. And on the right, he starts shooting. And he said, what'd you see? He's screaming, what'd you see? And I didn't hear him say this, but the story is he said, two dogs and a chicken. He'd been drinking. So we are told that there are all these enemy troops in the village. So we make a left turn. We go in single file like this and run into immediate enemy fire. Well, I can read from here. We were to be very certain of our targets, so we turned 45 degrees and right into the opposite side. We had driven the night, many cold beer. I talked about Childs. Once we got that quieted, we started going in with members of the 101st Infantry.
Which 101st unit? Airborne.
Airborne. Thank
Airborne,
you.
Right.
They would be very offended.
They would be very insulted that you didn't call them
no
Airborne.
Leg.
Yeah.
So they're going with us. Uh-huh. They're beside us. Some behind the tracks, some in between the tracks.
Good combat
troops. We start taking some heavy enemy fire. And we respond. We actually knock down a hooch, just go right through it. to get where we're going and to see where the fire is coming. That's all you can see is the tracers and the bushes shaking, uh-huh. this sort of thing. So we go into the village. We drove off the paved road we were on. 50 yards further, we started drawing the fire. It seemed to come from all over, but from my part, I could only see thick brush to my left. And then an enemy machine gun started firing from an oblique angle at about 11 o'clock on the clock. Uh-huh. That's where he's firing from. It was pretty easy to identify since the brush was moving and dust and smoke were coming from it, and the enemy used green tracer rounds that I could see flying over my head, and I could hear clanging against the side if the track was bouncing off my gun shoe. So they're shooting at me.
Yeah,
that guy's shooting right at
gets
me.
Gets personal, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's yeah. the straw. Mm-hmm. That's a good analogy. So I start shooting, you know, what do I say? Good morning, Vietnam, yeah. right? I started firing back with my M16 machine gun to lay down suppressing fire. There was a problem, however, and it involved the orientation angle of our track. In order to hit the enemy position, I had to fire over the driver's head and react quickly. The driver's hatch was open and oriented to the left, which placed it right in my only line of fire. So the guy's shooting at me, I got to shoot back. Doesn't yeah. seem to be anybody else shooting at him. I'm not even sure I even saw that hatch. So it was just a thing like this that flips over.
Yeah.
I was so focused on my target 30 yards in front, and I put so many rounds that I shot that aluminum hatch cover right off. I never saw the crew. I never saw the crew. I mean, I saw the bullets, but I never saw the human beings.
Yeah.
Operating that enemy gun, but I know it did stop firing. One of the questions that people ask returning U.S. troopers is, did you ever kill anyone? My answer is a resounding, I don't know. They shot at me too many times and missed, and they shot at me and hit me a number of times. I'm still here. And there's a good chance they are, too. I have no way of knowing whether I hit or killed that team. That would be true for the rest of my experience in combat. We returned fire at enemy positions shooting at us or at suspected enemy positions. In free fire zones, which were areas where we shot at... I just had an epiphany.
What?
There's another story coming. It's probably my saddest story of the whole thing, or one of the two saddest stories. Most of these I try to make humorous for my family. But I did kill somebody. I'll get back to that. Never occurred to me.
Maybe you've been blocking it all these years.
Oh, I knew it. I wrote about it in here. But I didn't think of it that way. In free fire zones, which were areas you could shoot at anything that moved, we often used reconnaissance by fire. We were way too loud and too big, and we shook the ground as we moved so we could not sneak up on the deaf or the blind. What we did was shoot at enemy ambush spots to see if they would draw their return fire before they did it. So I'm in the battle. There's a lull in the action. The enemy withdrew deeper into the village, and we hooked up with the 101st Company again that would operate with us. We provided them with heavy weapons fire. I've already talked about that. We're now facing in the same direction, and we cut through to get to where we want to go and then run into a tree. All right? Big, big tree. And my machine gun gets stuck in the branches of the tree.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't pull it out because one of the side levers, I think the right-hand one, maybe the left one, it was the left one, comes down. So they pull up like this next to the gun, but then they pull down like this to provide a tripod or mm-hmm. a bipod. And you got to push up on it to release it. So there's a spring out. You push up, and it releases and moves up like this. But every time I pushed up on it, the barrel of the gun went up.
Yeah.
So I'm pushing up, and I can't get it the barrel to stop so I can pull this back. So I'm getting frustrated. I mean, I'm stuck. I got to have my gun.
Yeah.
We are stopped. We're not going to tear through this tree for whatever reason. We stopped.
Right.
So I can't do it. So I decide, well, hell, I without thinking, I reach out and grab the barrel of the M60 to hold it, and I'd put about 1,000 rounds out already. And, you know, once you start shooting, our rule was you keep shooting. You don't fire but 100 rounds. That was our rule. You start down here, as close as you can get without banging into the side, and lay out fields of fire like that.
Right.
They don't want them popping up and shooting you. So I fired
fire. Just fire the whole range fan.
Yeah. And I burned the hell out of my hand.
Yeah.
So then I end up for the rest of this fight off and on putting it in that ice chest to try to cool it down. Finally figured out to use a towel to wrap it with a towel and pull it down.
For somebody that's never grabbed a hot barrel, they cannot appreciate this story. I have.
Yeah.
And it took the skin off of my hand.
It
is hard. Man, I know exactly what you're talking about. Anyway, go ahead.
So I talk about how this happens later about a cook-off. Sometimes your gun gets so hot that instead of the firing pin setting it off, the heat from the barrel sets it off.
And it can explode in your face, too.
Yes. We call them cook-offs.
Uh-huh.
And it's one of the ways you could tell old guys from new guys, because it would backfire and you'd get the cordite. Uh-huh. Like blackheads all over your face. And that's how you could tell people who have been in a real battle. Real battles, even when you're on the ground, aren't like these World War II jump up.
No.
You could tell by the scrapes on your chin, because you put your face in the dirt and try to dig a hole with your chin.
You do.
And that's how you could tell who had been.
That's a great graphic description of it.
After pulling my gun free from the hungry tree and using a towel to fix it, we get into the clearing in the middle of the village, and we start receiving fire from another side. And somewhat we belatedly realize that we're being shot at from an unusual source. There was a large haystack about 15 feet high in the clearing. It's probably where they got the stuff for the roof. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a machine gun in there shooting at us. And they had basically a concrete bunker of some kind that they had thrown the hay over, and they had firing slots to fire machine gun fire at it. So we're shooting at it, and we figured it out only when the hay caught on fire and burned around it.
Uh-huh.
So eventually somebody brought up a law, which is a light anti-tank weapon, a one-shot yay job, and they hit that. Actually, I think they shot two or three at it and then threw hand grenades in. Uh-huh. There are incidents, side story, where we would catch a guy in a hole, and they wouldn't surrender. I decided not to tell this story, and we'd throw hand grenades in there, and mm-hmm. we threw three hand grenades in, and the guy survived in a small little hole.
Yeah.
That same story involved a medic. I cut this out earlier, but I'm telling stories. And they're not supposed to shoot. And one of our guys had gotten hit, and the medic was having to deal with one or two injuries, and he was pissed. And after running out of ammunition and fighting us for a half hour, one of them came out saying, "Chu hoy, chu hoy," and the medic shot him. And they said, "Oh, what are you shooting? What are you doing? Chu hoy, chu hoy. Don't you know
chu
what
hoy
that means?"
Means surrender.
Yeah.
I give
that's
up.
That's there. And they're supposed to surrender without fighting.
Yeah.
And the medic said, "Doesn't that mean me first?" And he shot him.
Me first.
Shot him. But so, yeah, it took us a while to clear that bunker. But meanwhile, they're running out.
Mm-hmm.
They're not yet. Okay, so let me go on the story. I tell it this way without reading it. They pull us back out after that. They don't know what else is in there.
Uh-huh.
There may be a whole lot more of these bunkers in the village. So they pull us back out. And
out of the village?
Out of the village. Back out of the village. 100, 200 yards out of the village on the rice paddies. And they bring in the jets. And the thing I remember is them dropping the bombs way behind you.
Uh-huh.
I mean, hundreds of yards behind you, and you watch them tumbling. And are they going to land on us, or are they going to keep on going and hit the village? And these are bunches of 250-pound bombs. And the concussion was such that the dust was raised all the way up, and it felt like, we may not have felt it, but it felt like they lifted a 13, maybe 15-ton truck of all our weight in it, just a little bit off the ground.
It jolted it,
and
I'm sure.
And I almost felt sorry for those guys.
Uh-huh.
So we go back in with the infantry, and they've gone. They've left the village, and they've gone to a tree line out on the other side of the village. You can tell it's basically a tree line because it's There's a hole some 4 to 10, 12 feet deep as it meandered. There was a lot of vegetation there because of the water, and that's where they set up. And we know they're there. They're shooting at us. We're shooting at them. They're like being in a, you know, being in a ditch is like being in a big foxhole.
Right.
And for what reasons I do not understand, there was a colonel now of the 101st who's taking charge, and he orders a frontal assault on this tree line. And they're hiding in the
ditch. Is it an open field from the village to the tree line?
Open field. And so they attack. And right off the bat, they're getting shot. They get wounded. One of them gets wounded. And one of their guys goes to save his buddy, and he gets shot. Mm-hmm. So there's two of them out there. And Alabama Child now, who's still drinking, says, well, this is what I didn't hear him.
Yeah.
He's on another track. But supposedly he said, well, damn. Gets off the track, runs out there, grabs one under each arm, and brings them back, for which he's awarded a Silver Star.
He should have been.
But, and he was medevaced out for exhaustion. He was probably medevaced out because he was drunk.
Drunk, yeah.
So then they tell us to go. So, okay, now we got armor.
Right.
And so we're lining up and running up and down.
You
and
got tanks.
Sectors and we didn't have any tanks. Just
no
armor.
Tanks, no just tanks. Armor. Okay.
Just us armor. And the 50 caliber basically stopped working. Both 60s, the barrels got so hot we couldn't use them anymore. And we usually have extra barrels, but we didn't have any extra barrels that day. So we're now running up and down, throwing hand grenades and using our M16s and shooting 45s.
Right.
And they eventually run and get out of the village. Mm-hmm. The infantry didn't have to attack.
Oh, good.
All of this has taken place within view of Tansanut Airport. Or the one, I guess that's in Benoit, closest to Benoit, right?
In Saigon.
Saigon?
Tansanut's in Saigon.
Maybe, what's the other one?
Benoit Airfield.
Airfield, not Tansanut.
Yeah.
We flew into Tansanut,
right.
But this was a battle.
Benoit Airfield.
Right on the runway of Benoit Airport.
Yeah, I'll tell you something about Benoit. Benoit Airfield, at that time in 1968, I have heard, was the second busiest airport in the world.
Oh,
compared to O'Hare, based on takeoffs and landings.
Yeah. Which, I don't know if I read this to you or not. They did very fast when we landed. They come in, I don't know if I read this to you or not. They didn't refuel.
They yeah,
get
you did
the guys
say
off
that.
And then take off real quick.
Yeah.
So that's where all this is going on. And that was my first big battle.
Uh-huh.
The machine guns blew up. We did not lose a man. We didn't lose anybody. The infantry had lost people and had a lot of wounded that we didn't have. So I'm talking about that here, and I wanted to read one particular part to it. And it deals with what I just read. What would cause such bravery from Americans who were mostly draftees, who mostly hated the Army, and who mostly hated this particular war? Those like me who volunteered for both the Army and for combat assignments were quickly disabused of our notions about fighting for a just cause. A lot of draftees, a lot of regular guys. I'm going back in history a little bit. In my basic training unit, there were two groups of people in my basic training company. There were volunteers that were processed through Atlanta, and there were draftees from Ohio. And they were draftees from Puerto Rico. Mm-hmm. And they really didn't want to be there. They didn't speak much English anyway. Seriously, some of them really didn't. Some of them did and pretended they didn't.
Yeah.
Don't blame them a bit. The draftees version was a lot different. But it didn't matter whether you're a draftee or volunteer once you got there. We often did not get along. That's talking soldiers, us, in not just basic training, but in our units. We didn't get along. We were, in fact, like a movie cliche of guys from different states and different religious beliefs. We were brown, yellow, black, and white, and came from inner-city ghettos and from farms in Iowa. We would fight and fuss and diss each other over our choices in music and hairstyles and the cars we preferred. And for only so long as it was understood that it was meant as a joke, we would cut girlfriends. We told outrageous lies about our sexual exploits. We entertained each other, and good storytellers were respected. We infuriated each other, and I often found myself exasperated by the ignorance of those who did not even finish high school. But we did respect each other's courage when it exceeded our own. We respected their skills that we did not possess. I, for example, am not mechanical, and many of my platoon grew up fixing engines and or went to mechanical training in armor school. Despite our differences, or maybe because of them, we loved each other. Mm-hmm. We did not fight for flag or apple pie or other overused platitudes. We fought for each other. If your guys got hurt, you responded instinctively out of love. And it wasn't really courage because you were not scared. You were pissed. Now, how later you got the shakes so bad you could barely move, and when asked, what did I do, because you had no idea. You had no recollection of what you just done. I don't know how drunk Child may or may not have been. It really doesn't matter. He would have done the same thing in any condition. Later that night, I got my ass reamed out by several members of my platoon for shooting off the driver's hatch and for shooting over the opening where the driver might poke his head up. The driver was very well liked, short timer, and I understood their concerns. The driver himself had no problem with my actions. He had seen what was going on, and while he probably messed his pants, he was cool with me. My hand was burning, I was shaking all over, and I was in no mood to put up with any bullshit. I made sure they knew that despite my brief time with them, I was no FNG and that I did what was right, and if I had to do over again, I'd damn well do the same thing. I had acquitted myself as well as most and better than some in the firefight, and so that ended any more FNG talk. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm getting close to... Okay, we commiserated with each other and with the men of the 101st who joined our NDP, Night Defensive Position. We were all shaken.
God, suffering. You're the only other one that calls it an NDP but me. Yeah, everybody else calls it Fire Support Base. I go, no, it's a Night Defensive NDP. Position.
That's what I thought.
What are you talking about? Yeah.
So we're all shaking, suffering from overdoses of adrenaline. That is when I made the single biggest mistake of my tour. One of the Screaming Eagles had taken a diary off the body of a dead NVA.
That is, by the way, for those listening, Screaming Eagle is a 101st Airborne 101st. Trooper or soldier.
He did not want to hump the extra weight of the diary, and I thought I could make a superior souvenir. So I traded him some cigarettes for it. The only excuse I can make for myself is that I was probably in a state of shock and had consumed a few of the now barely cool beers that we were sharing. The mistake was that the diary should have been turned over to military intelligence.
Amen.
I knew that, but once I put it in an airtight, empty ammo box, I forgot about it. This episode would come back to bite me in the ass and put me on the troop first sergeant's permanent shit list, starting a couple months later and lasting for the next 5 months after that. Oh. We're going to find out how he found out about it later. Our duty then became to escort truck caravans. How much time do you think?
5 minutes or so.
5 minutes. Okay. So we're escorting troop caravans. We're escorting supply trucks. We're sitting out in the jungle, but mostly we like to sit in the rubber tree plantations. The rubber tree was a great place. It was no jungle, because they cut down all the vegetation so the trees would get all of the nutrients. And then the breeze would come through, yet you'd be shade, and that's where we would sit and wait for something to happen. And this is what we did, usually up and down Highway 1. Usually a safe mission, usually not a bad day. we'd stop and put up some overhead to protect us from the sun. Before Tet, my unit was not liked in the big cities because we were dirty. We were always covered with dust. In the summertime, the dust would be so thick that they would, when they would dig ditches on the side, it would fill up with dust. You couldn't even tell the ditch was there. It was like the confectionery sugar, and it would be all over. You had to wear goggles. And we'd go in, there'd be white here and nowhere else on your body. And occasionally we'd get picked on for that. We took an engineering unit out, road builders, and went back with them that night and ate in their dining hall. And they were picking on us, making jokes about how dirty we were. And we ought to go eat somewhere else. And so next thing you know, just like the movies, a fight starts. They're fighting over my unit versus their unit. I sat with a fellow nicknamed Superman under the tables eating ice cream. But this is where we were. And then one of the problems was mines. You had to be real careful about mines. And so one of the techniques you had to learn as a driver, or you couldn't drive, was tracking, which meant you put your track exactly in the position of the one before you. If he mm-hmm. didn't blow up, you ain't going to blow up.
Uh-huh.
And so some people could learn to be drivers. I learned to drive on a 52 Chevrolet. Wheels this big because there's no power steering. Reach through it for a three on a tree stick shift. Driving a tank and a track was easy. You just did this.
Yeah.
You know? It was actually easy. I don't know what else I want to tell you today. Let me tell you about one guy. I don't know how much time we got. For the first 3 months I spent with 2nd Platoon E Troop, I had the same lieutenant, and he was outstanding. He had been in country 3 months before me. Officers generally only stayed in the field 6 months in a combat unit. I don't know about you.
No, I was in the field.
Yeah.
Off and on, I was S2 of 2nd Brigade for a few months, but I stayed in the field about 15 months.
Did you?
Out of my 18
our
months.
S2s generally were,
yeah.
And the headquarters company was generally wasn't online.
I had to brief the old man every night, so I had to be back in headquarters every night.
But. And lots of officers stayed only 6 months, even in high-ranking commands. This is one of my teaching moments that I put in this story.
That's the way it worked. They had you were supposed to get 6 months here and then change jobs, so you had a lot of combat.
But colonels from all over the Army wanted to come to Vietnam to get that combat experience on their resume, and some of them were good and some of them weren't, and a lot of young officers weren't good. My lieutenant was absolute top-notch.
Yeah.
Outstanding. He had been in country for 3 months. He knew what he was doing. He handled his men very well and did his best to take care of us. I never knew how he got his commission. He could have been a West Pointer, ROTC, OCS. Mm-hmm. All of them had their positive and negative qualities. What he did have was a father who was a general.
Ah, well, there's your answer right there.
He would not put up with stupid orders from some superiors who, without any experience or knowledge of the situation on the ground, issue life-threatening commands. He never became insubordinate. He never directly disobeyed orders. He did manage to accomplish the mission without putting his men in unnecessary jeopardy. Maybe because of his father's rank, or maybe because of his qualities as a man, he developed a wonderful give-a-shit quotient, and I felt lucky to have him.
What was his name?
I don't remember. I think I found it at a reunion.
Yeah.
But and this is what happens after 51 years. You lose names.
Yeah, you do.
I want to tell a story about a guy named Willie who basically saved my life,
mm-hmm.
And I can't think of his last name. And I hate that. All right, I got one more story and we're done. Have you got time?
One more.
On my 21st birthday, it was not very happy for me. We're down to the dregs of C-ration case, and all we had left was ham and lima beans. There were maybe 5 different meals that came in a case, and some were decent, and some could be doctored up to taste okay, but not ham and lima beans. Anyone who had them can tell you that our name for them was Hammond Motherfuckers.
It was the worst crap ever devised by man.
The name does not do justice to how truly horrible they were. I felt like I deserved something better for my birthday, and so I opened up a new case and ate peaches for breakfast. Someone bitched about it, so the lieutenant decided I need to pull LP that night, listening post, two man. Go out and make sure you don't get overrun, and you're bait, basically. So that's where I spent my night, was out there in a heavy jungle, at the two-man listening post, where they can sneak up on you, and you're trying to stay awake. And that was my 21st birthday. I will stop here and show you a picture.
I want to ask you two quick questions.
Please do.
You told me about your first wife. You ultimately remarried.
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
And do you have any children?
Two sons.
And where are they here?
They are in Atlanta.
Uh-huh.
One right now, this very moment, is in Australia.
Oh.
One of them does what he loves, and the other one makes money.
Okay.
My oldest son is a chef. My youngest son works for Turner Broadcasting.
He worked
for CNN.
Yeah.
He went up and worked for WWE. He's a television technician.
Oh, yeah.
And he's on vacation with a friend who's in the military, who's getting married. He works in Alice Springs at a radio station. I think he's Air Force.
Okay.
At a radar station, not a radio. Radar station in Alice Springs. And he's going to spend two months down there.
And after you got out of the military, you taught history. You told us
after
about
I
your
After I got
education.
Out of the military, I went to school for 7 years.
Okay. All right. We'll do that on part two.
Became a teacher.
Okay.
1 minute left.
1 minute. That was a picture taken on my 21st birthday. And I couldn't drink that on the mission I'm going to tell you about next. I know right where I am. But I'm going to end up drinking that in one night after our next mission. So that was taken on my birthday, and I didn't get to drink it for a while. And that's a great place, because I have got a lot more to tell. I've got two more war stories and all kinds of other
stuff. Okay, good.
If you're enjoying, you seem to be enjoying it.
We love it, but we're going to have to continue because we're running out of tape.
Have to continue. And then you can look through all this stuff.
Sounds great.
And see what you want to make copies of. If I come back, and if it's easier, I can bring you those photos.
Yeah.
On a flash drive.
Yes, that would be fantastic.
Yeah, that's what I forgot. Now, I got all these other photos, but okay. I just...
Frank, you need anything for the first part?
No,
okay.
All right.
All right, we're going off the record now. And it is now 13:10, I believe, on...
I thought I'd say
January.
In an hour.
April the 11th, it's still April 11th, 2019, and we're going to end Volume 1 and start Volume 2 when we can rearrange it.
Perfect.
Okay.